on their own. I mean, they have since gone on, they now produce the Nanny, so, you know, they have a wonderful gift, God bless them, and I wish them well. But with the Charmings, they were first-time producers, and someone put a bug in their ear that I was too much like Snow White, and that the series should be more modern and more contemporary. And I think the real problem was is that there wasn't an agreement on the vision. There wasn't an agreement on the concept. And as you know, this, the show completely fell apart. Yeah, it wasn't cohesive. It was a charming idea, but, you know, it wasn't, it never held together. And I loved that character. I really did. And you had another question? Yes. Not at all. No. It was great. I love Eric. Oh yeah, we had a great time. It was so wonderful. I didn't know that he was. Let me see. Did I play Alienation before I did? It was that same time. I don't remember. I didn't. That's right. When I auditioned for Alienation, I didn't realize that Eric was on that. And I remember coming onto the set. It was such a wonderful reunion. He's a great guy. Wonderful to work with. It was wonderful, the whole experience. There again, Alienation. I made friends with the makeup woman, Michelle Burke, on Alienation, and she's now one of my best friends. Yeah. No more questions? Yes?
I have been trying, like Matt, my videos of Alienation. I was out of the country most of the time, I was on the air. I've seen like two episodes of that, and one for each character.
Hey, you wouldn't really recognize me too well, because I was wearing one of those head things. I was an alien, and not only was I an alien, I was a disfigured alien. I mean, it's not enough that they disfigure you by putting that thing on your head, but then they like did this whole thing to the side of my face because I was a burn victim. Yeah, so if you didn't recognize me, there's good reason. And I thank you for not recognizing me. Yes. What would you like to know? I mean, I can't really. I mean, I don't know.
How do you feel about?
Okay. Well, what happened with Christopher, and I'll be very honest with you, is that he had such an overwhelming response to what had happened to him that I never could find out whether he had received. We tried. I left countless messages. I called his phone, and I couldn't get through. And that's the absolute truth. Yeah, I mean, if you have to think back at that time, he was inundated with messages and cards and the whole thing. And so, and it was frustrating. But I had to, you know, not take it personally. So don't any of you take that personally. I mean, it's just that we did our best, you know, we left numerous messages for him, but couldn't get through. Yeah. Absolutely. Well, Bobby, with the situation in Ireland these days, I think she'd be at the forefront. Right? I mean, actually, to tell you the truth, I went and listened to Bernadette Devlin, and in my mind, when I was developing the character of Bridget, I used Bernadette Devlin as a role model for this character. Are you familiar with Bernadette Devlin? Yeah. And when I was in New York last year, she spoke, because that was at the time that the peace agreement had happened, and Jerry Adams was in New York speaking. And she came and she spoke at the local union, 1091 or whatever it was, over on 45th Street. And I went and listened to her speak. And she's such a wonderfully passionate, intelligent woman. And that's what Bridget, I mean, she's not at the forefront. Bernadette Devlin isn't really at the forefront right now. But she's important enough that people listen to her, and she's intelligent enough that people listen to her. And so she does go around speaking, and I think that's basically what Bridget would be doing too. She would have continued her work for peace, of course. So much trouble over there. You know, I mean, if you just look at the paper today, and look what's going on today over there, I mean, it's just, it's insane. It's sad. But I do work on characters, it's, I probably shouldn't, long after the show is closed. I still find moments, and I'll think, oh my God, in that scene, I should have done this, and I could have done that, and I could have worn my hair this way, said this line that way. I continue to work on it. I did that with auditions, hey. Well, my heritage, as far as I know, actually, I've just started working on my genealogical chart. And I traced my grandfather was born in Derry, which is where Bridget is from, Edward. And his mother was Eliza O'Regan. So that's I've only taken that back as far as my great-grandparents in County Derry, Ireland. And then my maternal grandmother is German, and we've traced that back to 1742. My great-great-great-grandfather, who not only founded Pabst Blue Ribbon Beer. Yes, I'd like a percentage of that. And maybe I'll still get it. I wonder. He was the mayor of Bentheim, Germany, and then he came to America and he founded Best Beer. So if any of you drink Pabst, you'll notice that there's a seal with the letter B, and that stands for my great-great-great-grandfather, Jacob Best. And the year that he died, he left Best Beer to his partner, Pabst, who had married his daughter, Marie. So I am actually blood related to the Pabst family too. In fact, in high school, there was a girl that was there named Heidi Pabst. We looked at twins, basically, yeah. And the slogan that year was, the best beer is Pabst. So that's German. And then there's talk that my maternal grandmother was Welsh. Her name was Crosigro. And David Hemmings, do you know David Hemmings? Yes, so David Hemmings and I worked together and one time, and he's Welsh, and he said, oh no, without a doubt, Crosigro is Welsh, it means by the sea, and your friend, and my mother's maiden name is Perdandi, and she said that was German, and I always said, that doesn't sound German to me, Perdandi, and he said, no, that's Welsh too. I have no idea. All I know, I can tell you, is that my grandfather, who was named Fernandy, was in the circus. He was a tightrope walker. Yeah, oh yeah, this is a great story. I never met him. A lot of family stuff, you know? And one day, when I was in high school, I was going through a box of pictures that my mother had gotten because he had died. And I picked up this picture of this beautiful woman, right? And she had like wavy brown hair, and she was in this rosettes and spaghetti strap dress and the whole thing. And I said, wow, who's this beautiful woman? And my mother said, well, actually, that's my father. And I said, so maybe there's a reason why I haven't met him. I mean, and she said, no, none of that. She said, he was in the circus. And I said, what? He was in the circus? And she said, yes, he was a tightrope walker. And then there were all these publicity pictures of him. And he and his partner would switch off playing the woman. We won't go into it, that's as far as we'll go. Interesting family background. Yes. I don't have a talent for the tightrope myself. But. Oh, the accents. Well, I have to tell you now, that Bridget O'Donnell accent, I hate to disappoint you, it's more of a Dublin. That means it's more like, you know, that I have my friends from Dublin and they talk like that, and it's like I feel like it's all out of the sight of the watch. You know, and if everything is down there, you're kind of always going, what did you say? Because everything's down there like that. And that's not at all the accent that Bridget would have had. She would have had a Belfast Derry, and that I could not learn that in that time. I had 24 hours before we started filming.